Hey everybody, what's up? You've just missed some really dramatic fly swatting action, but here we are live from Korea. We're in Busan at the, I guess, what's this place called? The Baytox or?
Bexco.
Bexco so building. There's an X and an O and a B and just some variety of it, but we'll be casting the Elima League Finals live from here. We're actually been set up really nicely in this awesome Twitch booth. I'm super, super stoked for it. You guys can also see the patrons. Oh, if you're a Patreon, keep an eye out for your name, screenshot it, and tweet it at us or something like that. But we are kind of flying a little bit solo right now. So I do believe that the main stage will be hosting people soon. I wish we had a webcam. I mean, there's like literally like a thing there. You guys can't see. The camera has like a taped off area.
Hold on. What an idiot.
Anyways, we can't show you because we've got no control of this camera. And the clean feed's currently not up, but there's a pretty nice-sized audience here, actually. It's not packed or anything, but the front row is actually full of Byun's fangirls.
Yes, for
we
sure.
thought they were just random attendants. We learned that they were actually straight-up fangirls of Byun.
I had a suspicion. There's literally one girl starting at, like, 10:30, all right? So that was, like, 4 hours ago, guys.
Yeah, she was here, like, super early.
Just, like, on her computer. I think she was, like, calling the herd, you know? Caw-caw! That's what you do, right?
Yeah, that's totally...
They're coming, caw-caw!
Yeah, cookie, cookie.
It's what cacao. All
right. Oh, because you're the messaging server. Okay, now I get it. Anyways, we'll be covering as many or all the games live today. There's two semifinals, one grand finals. We actually, I was trying to bring it up, but I minimized it. A lot of people have been asking about the prize pool for this. So it's about $5,000 in total. We got $3,000 for first place, so Byun gets $3,000
yes.
today. $1,000 for second, and $500 for third and fourth. So everybody's going to walk away with a fair amount of money today, but of course it's the first place prize that has all the dollars on it. Now, they're playing, I guess, this live on the main stage. We're hearing this, wow. We actually, I thought they had already played it. That's what we played
ours. They
definitely
played it twice. That was pretty good.
By the way, we're going to have a lot of resubs and Twitch subs today. It's a little bit hard for us to track. We don't have Twitch alerts up and running as per usual. So quick just shout out to Bloodwolf Bane for the Twitch Prime sub, Darth Silius, Kiwi and Metros, anyone that's subbed to us more recently. We're going to swap to the game scheme for just a sec, though, so you guys can see. I think they're just showing off the Twitch booth and some
of
the arena.
Yeah, there it is. That's where we're at.
Yeah, this is so cool. You guys can't see. They're probably not going to show us. We're going to be like in the little left side of the
hold
booth.
Hold on.
Can we?
No, come on.
Just a little bit shy. So if they got just a little bit further, you would have seen our wonderful faces. But this arena looks so cool. Oh, is this where I stick? You
hold
see
on.
My arm.
Yeah.
You see Woo. My arm.
We're famous.
Yeah, anyways, so we'll go back to the Korean casters. We'll let them do their thing. We'll wait to get into the game. But we're going to be giving a clean feed. We're casting all this stuff, like, super live. We actually were hanging out with Gumiho and Ryung and...
The Terrans.
The Terrans, basically. So he was kind of doing a lone wolf thing. He was doing his own thing.
Yeah.
But he's got to be working the hardest today, man. He's the only non-Terran here.
Actually, I think Gumiho's worked the hardest, right? Because he had two matchups to prepare for.
That's right. Actually, and they could both
it's
be like the worst ones of all time, right?
TBT and TBZ.
Well, you know what's scary? Actually, Byun, or not Byun, excuse me, Gumiho's probably in the worst position of this whole tournament. Because one, he has to deal with Zerg. And that Zerg is Sue.
Yeah.
But then you take that one step further. Either Ryung or Byun are both players. Like, it's gonna be a tough time for Gumiho, I think, today. I hope him the best. We were actually kind of cheering, though, for his TBZ finals, so as much as I do love Gumiho, I wouldn't be too upset if Sue won, because I think it would make for a much more dynamic grand finals.
Oh, I think Sue is going to win, actually. I mean, the last time they played, it was Gumiho showing off trying to be a mech master.
He did mech in the Elima League,
It didn't really work out. It works against Lucira, but not Sue. I like that someone pointed out that we're usually on the opposite sides of each other. Feels
Oh my god, that's
awkward.
Right. Hang on, can we do
this? It's because we're on the other side of the world, guys.
How do I, it, will this work? Will I get in trouble
Are you
going
to flip it? Oh my
But now
it's perfect.
But now Twitch is back.
It's almost perfect. I like that side so much more for me. Flip it back.
You know, it's weird because it's just, there's something strange about this, but naturally you've been on the right, been on the left, and it's just how I've always done the cameras, and it just felt right.
We did this, is the way we were at Healthable Time too, though.
Maybe just live casting, we got to swap
spots. Yeah, live casting is swap, just to make sure you guys know we're live casting.
Maybe. But anyways, the Korean casters and commentators, they're actually right up there. They got beautiful lights on. They look fantastic. The Korean stream is going on simultaneously. So twitch.tv/ElimaLeague. If you guys want to watch the Korean version, watch for that little bit of extra hype. But as said, quite a bit of money on the line. A lot of awesome games to be had. I think the first one is Ryung versus Byun. I don't know if they're playing out of order or not, but that's what I was told first. Do you know if that's... Can we first?
I don't.
Well, we'll find out as soon as they're ready to introduce them. The booths, by the way, look so cool. I can't wait for you guys to see some of this, as we'll show you more of the live feed later.
Yeah.
I took some pictures as well. Check our Twitter, as we've been tweeting about a lot of the venue and some of the stuff we've been seeing. Unfortunately, and just so everyone is chance aware, we can't really hear what you're going to hear through the stream when we use the live feed.
No.
So when we swap over to the Koreans talking, I actually have no idea what they're saying or if you guys can hear us or
anything
like that.
It's going to be awkward, yeah. Also, there's only, I mean, he's the one with a keyboard and a mouse. I have the chat up here, but I'm going to be staring this direction this entire time. It's going to be kind of awkward.
Wait, which direction? Use your hand to point.
This direction.
High five.
Oh. I knew it was going to be something stupid like that, too. You know, that's why I did it. Good God.
Anyways, I think we're almost ready to go into the game soon. Or I'm guessing, to be honest, the problem is, like, you've got, like, you know, Tasteless and Wolf and all those guys. They kind of speak a little bit of Korean. So they can do some guesswork, take, like, one ear off and be like, oh, yeah, it sounds like we're about ready to go. I don't speak a lick of Korean. You guys are stuck with us.
Koreans always do the intros the same exact way throughout all of sports. Not even just esports, but sports. And I'm not going to mimic it, right? But it's the same, like, you know, the announcer guy comes on for, like, the GSL, and he's super, super loud and super dramatic. They all do that. So I feel like I would be able to know, because it'd be like, da-da-da!
It's just, like, the cue's coming in. Yeah, I guess.
We don't really do that. We're like, hey, he's the game. Woohoo!
Yeah, we're ready to go. There's the stuff and the thing with the whatever.
The things. It's also like, I was watching the Overwatch cast, because, of course, Overwatch on OGN is live on the TV in, like, my room, right? It's the Korean cast. But
oh, yeah, we got to watch that in the hotel a little bit, too. Yeah,
this headset's too big for my head. But anyways, and it was, like, the same thing. Like, the way they say hello, like, the introductions for every single, like, Korean cast is always so similar. And I feel like you just cannot replicate it in English, because they literally go, like, hello, welcome to the cast today. Hello, Rifkin.
It's, like, too much hype. Yeah.
Hello, Rifkin.
Hello, Zombie Grub.
Hello, Kanata. Hello. And then we're going.
Like, actually, hey, say it
too
again.
Formal.
Do it again.
Hello, Rifkin.
No, to the other guy.
Oh, hello, Kanata. It's too formal, though. Like, I mean, I feel like it's not even just, like, you know, basic TV thing, but even, like, when, like, DreamHack, like, moves in, they're, like, they're pretty chill, actually.
Yeah. Like I said, though, guys, seriously, if any of you guys are big supporters of the Patreon, I'd love to take a screenshot when your name scrolls by. Tweet it at us. It'll be good to see that sort of stuff. Plus, get some more pictures of our beautiful mugs out there on the internet, real silently. But yeah, so VSL's producing a lot of this, since Ellen's asking a chat. We're kind of on our own.
We're leeches.
Yeah, we'll go to this side. Again, I'm muting it because I don't know how loud it's going to be or not. We're not getting this audio in our ears. But if there's any problems on the stream, we're going to really rely on you guys to let us know.
So
we can fix so many of the problems, but we won't know about them
because we can't
hear anything.
I was going to say, like, so Maynard's giving us, you know, production tip advice, right?
Oh.
It's not that easy for us, so I can kind of do it because I'm closer to the soundboard, but he is, like, there's like, one soundboard
there's
right
no
here.
There's no way. I can't.
So, like, there's going to
the
be a cord
already
in front
stretched.
Of him.
Yeah. Not gonna. Maybe I can hide it behind my...
I look professional as fuck. I mean, as hell.
There we go. That doesn't look really weird. I'm just going to keep my neck kinked a little. No, that's not going to happen. But yeah, they got players being introduced, so let's leave this on. Ryung looking super, super stoked.
Why is his headset so big?
Why is your head so small? You ever consider that?
No. Oh, thank God. I found, like, the tiniest little bit to push it in more.
So I got some really big stuff that I need you guys to tweet about. I need you to spread the word about. We got some really good news today. And we weren't allowed to announce it until earlier, but then I forgot when they told us we could announce it because I was so excited about it. But we'll be back on the 20th, casting the VSL Team League Finals.
Yes, that's correct. You'll see the same production setup.
Yeah, so it'll be our same. Like, this is the thing, investing in the future for you guys. Whatever messes up here is going to mess up on the 20th. So let us know if there's any issues with audio, if there's any issues with stuff so that we can get that fixed. But please spread the word. Let people know there's going to be a live English cast for the VSL finals. We're going to be doing it here. Same spot, same place, same Korea, all that good stuff. And I'm not sure.
How do we expect you to move the mic? No, the chat's telling you to move the mic over here.
Oh, well, you know what? Maybe none of that matters. Time to get in the game.
How are you going to do that?
Also, so here's the problem. I don't see any audio blips, so I don't know if there's actual game audio. And they said that they would. So.
Yeah!
Yeah, a little unsure about that. But anyways, get
you guys
in the
tell
game.
Us.
I guess we can't even do our intros like normal. You take over for one sec.
All right, then. We're not going to be doing. Well, actually, I guess they. Okay, how do tastes do this, actually? I've never done intros when I don't have control over the camera, you guys. I'm freaking out right now. In the bottom right, as the Blue Terran, he is Ryung. And you can see partially Byun in the top left. Exactly. They have game audio. But we can't
adjust it.
Yeah, if it's too loud, we can't really adjust it.
Tell me if this works, guys. I just turned that down like to 30%. You let us know if that's working or not. We got, of course, only Molly Craig can stand by and some other people help and handle things, but like I said, it's our start.
Yo, but seriously.
There'll be some bugs here. We'll work them out as we go. It'll be all good.
Well, the input delay, I guess, is still kicking in. I've never done intros like DSL, you know, where like you don't have control over the camera.
Didn't change at all, they said. So we have no control over the audio.
Well, this is already all the way down, so that is not the sound.
Okay, well, they're going to try and fetch somebody. We're just going to talk really loud!
Jesus
like, it's
Christ.
Super hype!
Please, God, no.
Here comes the SCV!
For the love of God. Blown out my eardrums.
Give us a moment, because we've run to go try and find somebody for production. I'm trying to see if there's anything to do on my end, but the sound switcher we have,
yeah,
I've been advised not to touch.
Wait, we already touched it. Well, that's a good question. I also wonder what this word says. Oh. I don't know. I'm not gonna touch anything. Hey, pig! Thanks for the resub. But you're enjoying all the Korean food and Korean culture and food. Rifkin, why would you say he's enjoying it? We all know that's not true.
I love this, though. That's why the Koreans are always yelling, because the volume's too loud. It makes a lot of sense.
So much sense.
All right, guys, I know it's loud. I know you can barely hear us. Give us a moment. We're trying to get it fixed. We don't have control over this, unfortunately, but we've sent someone out to get it fixed. So just to talk a little bit about the game, I guess, because I really...
Some things are happening. Whoa, white person!
Whoa!
What?
All right. Well, again, we can't actually hear anything in our headsets, so we don't know how loud this is, but... I was going to comment, Byun and Ryung, we actually did a lot of like research for this, right? And these guys have played a lot. But what I found really interesting when I was going through VODs and records and stuff is... Oh, hold up one sec. We may have an update.
So it's all good. They're gonna fix it.
So it should be getting fixed, guys. Anyways, we went back all the way to 2015 to talk about these guys. And I was noticing like Ryung and Byun played September 2015 for the Elite League, right? Then, of course, they've been playing more recently. But their builds were almost the exact same a year ago as they are now.
Yep, that's one thing that's consistent in Legacy of the Void, certainly, is TVT. And, of course, we've been seeing this a lot. It's not too surprising.
The Reapers and the Hellions.
I mean, they all expanded. There's not going to be any game overs here. It is, of course, the chance of a snowball, but it usually doesn't happen that way. These guys are so good. These guys are so well matched for each other. It looks like the sound has been fixed. Thanks for letting us know, guys. Here we have a little scuffle. Again, like, this should not snowball
too
much.
But it's kind of actually getting out of control. There's only one Hellion left. The Reaper goes down, sure, but he's going to get some SCV kills. As the aliens wrap around, production's going to be the only thing to maybe keep Ryung alive.
He's getting a Cyclone, which will actually be enough. I mean, all
of these
are definitely
that SCV
very low.
The shot from the alien.
That should be enough, actually. The Marine's popping out right now.
Yeah.
Yep.
Off chance,
Byun was following up with a Banshee, Ryung also is going to have defense for that. He's actually not, but I mean, that's one of the reasons that you do want to try and get in there, is you get a lot of the SCV's health low coming after. But it's actually a medevac follow-up. I love Korean production, by the way.
Yeah, just constantly cutting
down. People, guys.
Real quick, too, I was going to note, actually, we have a Cyclone going across a lot earlier than I thought. Hold that thought, because
he's
going to catch the medevac.
Yeah.
No, Ryung, are you this good? There's a Viking to go with it, too, so he only needs a couple of shots.
Oh, he's a little mistimed, unfortunately.
Uh-oh.
He's so close
he's
to finding it.
He's still
if the Cyclone gets on top of it, it's totally
dead. There's the lock
dead. On. It's dead.
All right, so the medevac's going to go down for sure. That's awesome. The Cyclone dies, but totally worth it. Stops the drop. That is a tank of three Aquamarines in the middle of the map. That's not threatening at all. Behind this, Ryung's also going for cloaked Banshees. Again, something back to 2015. These guys have not had to vary this up a lot. TVT is actually, I would even argue, still very similar to that first time we saw that first tournament right out of Legacy of the Void, fresh out of the gates.
The TVT tournament?
Yeah, I mean, aside from where people are choosing to build their Cyclones, really, this is the one matchup that hasn't changed much over time.
No, it really hasn't. I mean, like anything else in a game, an expansion, you're going to get the really cheesy builds first and the greedier builds later, but even that didn't really, like, it's been so consistent because, of course, everyone knows, if you ever played TVT, that the chances of a 3-rack are still pretty damn high for Reapers. But it looks like Byun did make a second medevac here, and he brought everything over. I mean, like, it stalled the push out for a little bit, but it made the next push still almost just as big. I mean, he really got the medevac in two Marines. Marines. That's a lot of Marines. Byung was very greedy on the third base and putting it there. Byung automatically gets a lead from that as his is already halfway done.
Yeah, and back at home, there's not even that much to defend with. The Banshee's going to be his saving grace here, maybe, with a question mark. If the Cyclone goes down, he can certainly pick it off. The Marines are scary. The tank's firing to the backside. SCV's pulled to the back. No repairs on that Cyclone. That Banshee gets scanned. It gets picked off. Oh, barely. Well, SCV's chasing the Marines. Tank's gonna go down to the Marines. I think he's gonna hold, but not without losses. Yeah. Down to 29, workers 13 died. Other side of the map, some SCVs died. I'm guessing a Banshee got in over there too, but the tank falls, and Ryung holds.
He holds, but he doesn't really have enough to counterattack, unfortunately. He did lose a lot of SCVs with that, but of course, a lot of SCVs, that's something you can kind of make up or try and make up. But you can't really make up both of the SCVs and that third CC timing. Oh, it looks like he already built one in the main base, so that actually is not going to be too far behind. And down seven workers is something that this Banshee can certainly help out with. The first Banshee apparently already did a good enough work. This is actually just evening each other out still.
By the way, people are mentioning something about music. I'm checking. We don't have anything open. So again, you're going to have this first game of the day. You got to work with us, guys, because we don't have control of production, but we can get stuff fixed. So if there's like weird music, or sounds too low, too quiet, you let us know. We thank you so much. But as we get this rough shot production out of the way, Ryung's coming in for his attack now. The Vikings, the Cyclone, like I really don't think the Banshee's going to get a lot done here.
No. He recognizes it too. I mean, this sounded like faux pressure. It did force Byung to push, to pick up. asking about the sound. It did force Byung to pick up his third command center, and that already, like, again, like, they're now they're kind of back to even as Byung is going to lift that. He hasn't turned an orbital quite yet. Ryung is now pushing his over after he turns into an orbital. These things are still really evening out, and it totally makes sense. Like, okay, it's a TBT. In a best of five, one or two of these games is going to be a snowball effect. Someone's going to get a cheese, they're going to have a build order win, or just, like, their micro's going to be better. That should happen, but for specifically Byung and Ryung in a TBT, this should be as even of a matchup as you can get.
Yeah. Again, just going back for a second. They have played so many times in the last 2 months. They've played so long over the course of the last year. Like, Byung and Ryung, not only just against each other, but the Alima League itself has been so Terran dominant. How many Terran versus Terran semifinals and finals have we had, right? Just one after another.
That's a good question.
So this is not a matchup either of these guys are unfamiliar with. Even if they were slacking and didn't play any ladder, no VSL, just the Alima League, they're still getting lots of TBT practice. Now, for Ryung and Byung, what I find most interesting here is forgetting the damage done up to this point, it's equaled out. They're on similar worker counts, their army's about the same, nobody with really distinctive upgrade leads, and everyone just getting to that third. This is actually really cool, because I thought Ryung was going to be a lot further behind from that first attack. When that tank came in, with the Reapers at the start, everything from this game looked like Byung was going to have big leads going to the mid game.
For sure, but even as much as that, like, that, you know, forcing that third command center to lift when it really didn't have to was a huge deal. Now, I do, of course, have King Sage on stage, but this is going to be an abusive position. They both had the same ideas. Basically, one person knew that the Viking control would give them an offense. Another person knew that, had to go for Vikings for the defense. So 3-3, they literally even out the Viking kill count, and Byung just leaves.
These guys are so well matched for each other, Soundgrim. I love it.
It ends up that Byung does take a little bit of a dip more in his army supply because of that. But again, these are things that this is like, you know, a good tank drop, you know, a good positioning is definitely going to make up. Everything else is so even.
Oh, look at that pickup on that tank, too. Keeps it alive a little bit longer. Yo, I had the pleasure and the honor of watching Byung when he did that tank micro live. They got the big Reddit thread about it. He's picking up and dropping versus the Immortal. Byung knows how to drop his tanks. There's no doubt about that.
Yeah. I mean, I say once upon a time, Byung actually had a weakness in TBT, like, let's say, like, 4 or 5 months ago. But he certainly fixed all aspects of his play in general. That's why he's a BlizzCon champion. But he's also, like, just thinking about it. And, like, while Ryung has done enough Alima League, like, once, you know, every while, a couple times throughout the year, but also more recently, like, of course, every single one, and getting second place in every single one, Byung, this is still his home territory, in my opinion. And especially being live where a lot more stakes are on the line after winning BlizzCon, I gotta say, like, Byung has, like, the home field advantage, I'm not gonna lie. Doesn't make any sense for a tournament, but whatever.
No, I get that same sentiment. I mean, personally, coming into this, I'm hoping for good things out of Ryung as well. A quick reminder, by the way, we didn't really go over because of the problems at the start, but this is a best of five, just so everyone's aware. But Ryung is, okay, he's the underdog, which I love, but he's also the guy who's been playing longer than even Byung has.
Is that true?
Yeah, Byung only started playing the Alima League a couple months ago.
Oh, sorry, the Alima League.
Yeah, excuse me, not StarCraft, I'm playing with the Alima League specifically.
I was like, wait a minute, I think like, they pretty probably started playing StarCraft at the same time. But anyways, we saw that Ryung anticipated...
Oh, Jesus.
Byung not making more Vikings, so he tried the same maneuver, but Byung actually did dedicate to a couple more Vikings, which... in my opinion, Vikings really do start to fall off. You know, once you reach that, like, above, like, 170, 180 supply, they're just, like, not worth the micro involved when you're trying to drop, like, 50 tanks. So, right now, especially since he is so tank-reliant, like, look how many Marines he has. They're just now joining him. The Viking control is pretty important.
Yo, concern is Comet Shields is coming in pretty late, too, for Beyond. That's going to be a lot harder to take tank-wise, obviously, but Ryung, I'm not sure if he'll be able to capitalize on this. I can't stress to anyone who's never Look at that split. It was amazing. I can't stress to anybody, though, who's never played TBT how big of a deal Comet Shields is. Like, Ryung really has about 30 to 60 seconds here where he could take a fight very definitively, I think.
Yeah, and you know what? Beyond does not have plus 2 armor on the way.
Again, Beyond is perhaps on these upgrades a little bit behind. His army looks good, though, so it's not like he's in a lot of trouble.
No.
But he could find himself at a disadvantage.
Yeah, I mean, this is it almost feels like he forgot about it because he is still. Well, first of all, he's still making Vikings, which it feels a little unnecessary, but he also already has a fourth commander on the way. Kind of eating dessert before regular dinner or whatever you want to say, but there finally is plus 2 armor on the way. I gotta feel like that's a mistake. Again, like something like better positioning with your tanks is probably going to trump that, but it's still a little concerning. Combat Shield is not quite done as they get into this engagement. Beyond, of course, being the aggressor, he wants to get Ryung to cancel.
Picks out the Vikings, gets one of them, almost gets all three. Really, really close there. Pulls back, and defending this fourth. I mean, okay, he's behind on this because Beyond got there first, but that's where, that was at the cost. Okay, cancel, he's still, it sucks, but it's that difference of upgrades. If it's 2-2 Marines against Beyond, who doesn't have the armor upgrade, again, Ryung can take a good fight. They're both pretty high in army camp. We got a walk by coming out here to the south. Stops to attack the depots. Looking to move and drop into the natural base too, maybe?
Yeah. Ryung's actually taking a huge dip in army supply, down by 20 now. So even as his plus 2 armor finishes, like 20 supply could probably trump that, especially with good tank positioning. He does get into the back line. Now he's killing a lot of SCVs.
And Ryung's looking like he wants to just go across the map. Turn this into a bit of a base trade.
That would be pretty great actually for the first game.
Goes for the command center, he should be able to get this. If he wasn't A-moving, if he was actually focus firing, these tanks get a lot of Marines though. Big pickoffs right through the middle of the map. That's the cannon fodder for the tanks. Beyond with a very small army now, does have to lose his command center. No cancel, it's a kill, so even better for Ryung.
This is now very interesting. I mean, tanks and medevacs are super scary, regardless if you have Marines, but the Marines are important to have, and Beyond doesn't have very many anymore.
Right, you need them to soak that fire, you need them to get on top of the tanks, their damage is fast, quick, and great, but there's a lot of SCVs not mining, there's a lot of missed minerals here for Ryung, so he's not necessarily going to for it. He's not repairing the command center, it's going to go down, starts repairing at the last second, in the red, down to 2 digits, it's dead!
Wow. Oh god, actually, that's good that happened, but the tanks almost lose their lives. This was a medevac.
It gets like an empty medevac. It's so unfortunate. Like, there's like 5 medevacs that are full. So Ryung finds himself in a very tough spot now. He's down in army supply. He's down in SCVs. He's supply blocked at 147.
Oh.
This doesn't go upwards. You're not playing macro at this point. You got to get some damage done.
Yeah, but I think that Ryung definitely has a chance to get that damage. He's only down 10 army supply. He does have that. Oh, no, he doesn't have that advantage anymore. Oh, the upgrades are all even, in fact. But he's still. Good positioning, a lot of Marines, a good concave when Beyond isn't looking. He doesn't know about the back, as a sensor actually. That is actually going to be the hardest thing to see with the live feed. But anyways.
Yeah, this is a little tiny circle we can really see.
Out-positioning of Beyond. I mean, Beyond is actually like all up in his natural, in fact. If Beyond could just come to the right, maybe he could have gotten to the third command center. But now it's going to be a huge fight. It's actually going to decide everything.
Beyond. He's got so many more Marines initially, but he starts losing them out as the reinforcements from Beyond. Come on in, GG!
Well done.
What a guy. Takes game number one. Oh, there's a view of the audience you guys can see again. That stage looks so awesome.
Yeah, a lot of people are going to be walking around and probably going to be just like seriously like gawking like behind the casters even, like behind the camera here.
It's also filled up quite a bit more from the from earlier. This was about halfway full, but now really full.
Yeah, I mean, like not going to lie, like a lot of it's probably going to be because of Beyond. I'm just going to say that straight up. Like
well,
Beyond has such a fan base in Korea. Like, of course, the Koreans
huge.
Have a Korean fan base, but Beyond even more so. He is like the loved guy, you know?
That's a good way to phrase it, I guess. For us, of course, again, we're going to be operating off of trying to dance. I love, by the way, I'm going to go back to this game. Some people are really loving the camera, and some people really are not.
There's not enough girls to show us how often they'll be like, no,
yeah,
dodge,
no, no,
dodge
no,
and
don't
weave.
Look, also, you guys can't see because they like taped them up. I guess I can't really lean over and show you either.
Oh,
we actually got Jane Eyre Greenwing chairs.
That's why they're green.
Yeah.
I mean, it's super cool. But yeah, some people ask him why they don't have chairs. So they just don't have chairs. Like, they don't provide the chairs.
Yeah, it's just not a thing.
It's not that really big of that big of a deal in Korea, you know? Like half the restaurants, you have to like sit cross-legged, which is not my jam, but it's totally fine for them.
Well, I think go back to this scene for a sec, guys. I'm just trying to fix some of the monitor stuff. We actually had this issue earlier where the mouse just disappeared on us for no reason. So things like Team Liquid and Twitter and all that disappeared. Yeah. We had Twitch alerts at some point, but like I said earlier, it's going to be really hard to do shout-outs. We love you guys. If anyone subbed or has joined us recently during the cast, please know that you are the best, but we just have no way to actually track that for today.
Yeah, try and catch it, but... So we also, like, I guess we don't know quite, like, how long they're going to be in between games. Also, like, we have a general idea of our own, right?
But yeah, like...
Maybe soon, as I think they're getting on the top of the cameras. That's usually the indication.
Yeah.
You're going to be going into a game. There it is.
There it is. Let's hop into it. Ladies and gentlemen, this timing's going to be weird, because in the bottom left side of Frost, he's currently not up one game.
Yeah, did we get that wrong?
Oh, well, luckily it's not me handling
it.
Okay, well, now on the bottom right side of the map, he's up one game. Ladies and gentlemen, it's the Red Terran player, Bjorn.
Pretend it's zooming in.
I know, and like swiveling. There we go.
Maybe I can match it. Like, I can kind of hear the Korean casters.
All right. Go for it. I challenge you on this one.
Okay. And in the bottom left, on Frost is the Blue Terran. It's Ryung.
Not bad.
I actually didn't hear that guy scream. The other guy definitely screamed for Bjorn.
Bjorn's worth screaming for his zombie grab. Now, of course, Scores got fixed, whatever. I was actually talking with Crank a little bit earlier. He was giving some kind of cool, fun stories about the Koreans while we're hanging out, waiting. And you know how there's like this very popular thing to do? We see them both do it a million times with the Reapers and the Hellings for the openers.
Yeah.
Apparently, it's Ryung who actually was the first one who started using that in Korea. Like, he was actually the one to set the...
The Reaper opener?
Well, not just that, but like the double Reaper, the Hellions getting aggressive with them, right?
Oh, yeah. He loved that.
Yeah, so apparently that was all Ryung's jam, but then Bjorn kept winning with it where Ryung wasn't, so everyone just assumed it was Bjorn's build and started referring to it as Bjorn's build, especially in Korea. So Ryung always feels a little bit slighted, I guess, because it was like, you know, it's his baby, and someone else is the one getting the credit for it.
Yeah, Bjorn even tries to take credit for, like, the invention of the 3-Axe Reaper. Like, the invention and the perfection, and I'm like...
Bjorn is like...
I'm not sure.
I will credit Bjorn with a million things. He gets the gratitudes of me for all his great games. But if there's one thing I will never concede is that Bjorn has, like, amazing Reaper or anything. Like, every time
we watch Bjorn,
Reapers are his, like, Achilles heel.
Wait a minute. No, the first Reaper is his worst, though. If he only builds one Reaper here, which probably shouldn't happen, but say that he does, I guarantee, like, he loses it. There's just something about him where if he opens a one Rax, one Reaper, like, you know, maybe if it's a TDZ in the finals, after all, that he'll just lose it. He just doesn't like the first Reaper that much. The champ can say what he wants. I guess that's true. When you win a BlizzCon championship, I guess you're just like, yeah, I invented, like, potatoes. And you can't say anything about it because I won.
Oh. I was going to go see if we were on the Twitch front page or not, but I realized we can't because we're in Korea and it just defaults to the Korean page.
That's a good point, yeah.
A little bit awkward. But anyways, that first game, I don't think it's going to be too big of an indicator of these guys. We had very rough openings lead to very rough early games leading to, like, a decent mid game. These are both the type of player that will get aggressive quick. They're both the type of players that will go for Banshees and Cloak, especially if given the opportunity. So the question is not so much for me in the openers. Lower the depot, man. It's not so much in the openers, but it really is like control. And that's what I love about watching these two play. Because you mentioned the 3-Rax Reaper and all these other things, sure. But for the most part, these guys can bounce off of each other, I think, no matter what the openings are, and end up having a pretty good mid game.
We are getting something fixed.
They're sliding stuff, guys. This
oh,
could,
God.
This could go no, wrong.
No.
It could go good. We don't know. We're going to find out.
Oh, Jesus. We don't know what they're doing.
Yeah, we said production people come over and start fiddling with stuff. We didn't.
There's like an audience member, and they're like, yeah, we trust you. Anyways, yeah, so you're talking about the Banshees. And I'd say that actually, for me, Ryung has always been more of a Banshee player than anyone else. I don't know why. He just seems to like Banshees. Because he even uses it in TVZ, where Bjorn, of course, is more the 2-1-1 guy. That's definitely what he's well known for, but they are both going Banshees. I'm going to assume they're both going to follow up, though, with a Cyclone or a Viking or both. That's just the way you do. The days of, like, make as many Banshees as possible and hope you do more damage, it's like that was really 2015. People are a lot more smarter, and of course they want to play longer games, again, generally as the game continues to grow. As you see, like, already a second command center on the way. Wouldn't be too surprised if they both were on the third command center at the same time, too.
That was bold. That was really bold to do. I'm not sure what he was thinking about that. By the way, so we are recommending. That's why I was asking, guys, because I wanted to give a shout out to everybody watching who's never seen StarCraft before. Hi, hello. You're joining in for the Alima League. And I hope you come join us on the channel. Keep watching, because this is going to be a fantastic tournament. This first series today we're casting is a mirror matchup, so not the most dynamic thing of all times, but the second match today will be TVZ. So Terran versus Zerg for you, you regulars out there. But we do have Cloak finishing simultaneously. As said, these guys love Cloak Banshee, and it's been like this for a year. I did just bring up the stat earlier. It straight up astonished me when I was going through the VODs, and you find this game on Bridgehead from 2015 September, these two playing against each other, and these two playing each other the exact same way.
Such a map. Anyways, almost gets that Cyclone. At least that would have been a somewhat even trade for the Banshee, but actually doesn't end up going so well. And again, just trading out here. Byung getting some advantages.
Yeah, I mean, Byung comes out as with like slightly less workers. We'll see if this command center ends up getting him even further ahead, Byung that is. But again, for me, so very little of this is about the early game. And I know I'm not dismissing it. I'm not saying it's important or anything like that. But they are both so good at deflecting off of one another that I really think it won't matter. You could open with a Banshee. You could open with Reapers. You could go mech or something weird. And I still think both of them would survive for the mid game.
Yeah. Well, they did throw their command centers down at like pretty similar times. And of course, this is where like the little tiny things, like sniping that SCV, can start to add up. Byung throws down his production a little bit sooner, however, and he does have a little bit faster, or slower step, my bad. Well,
gets him with the lock on. Very nice.
Okay. That would have been really annoying for Byung if the SCV died again. Is he going to cloak? Well, I guess no point. He pre-scanned.
Scanned, yeah. So for those who don't know, goes down. What's really annoying, Banshees can totally kill Cyclones if given the proper circumstance.
Yeah, for sure. This is a kind of a ragtag group of units, Hellions and Cyclones. It almost looks like they're prepared to go for mech. They put the carries in their compositions, but they're not.
If Stim wasn't in the production to have for both of them right now, I would start talking about mech. This looks like that sort of opener. You've got a lot of Vikings we made on Beyond 2. Lock-on's looking a little bit messy, and looks like Ryong will actually come out of this victorious.
Oh, the last seconds micro on that one.
I love the loop-de-loop around the tower.
Yeah,
that was
really ring around the Rosie. Again, just getting a little bit of trades here and there, but it's more about that production tab, to be honest. They can be as fancy as they want with the units they have, but their units, there's not enough of them really snowball. Like, you get one tank left over, you're going to do a kill the LSCVs. So it is about, like, what do they have faster on production tab? And of course, Ryong does have that upgrade lead again. It didn't end up playing a part in that last game, as just everything circumstance-wise, they got into the heat of things by the time the upgrade had finished.
You know, it was so unfortunate, too, because I was hung up on the combat shields. It's not only as a player hard to remember to go for because it's not visually that noticeable, but as your enemy, too, you probably didn't know that Byung didn't have combat shields. Otherwise, I guarantee you he would have pounced if that had clicked for him.
Yeah. I love that I've already made a meme, by the way. Like,
oh, the half the zombie grubs have the chairs.
Yeah, can someone congratulate me for making a meme within like 15 minutes of a stream?
Nailed it. All right, these Cyclones get locked on. This was a really nice pickoff. Hit the last one with the last shot. But for Ryong, he's taking away air control. That was the one big thing Byung had coming out of the early game. By getting 4 to 5 Vikings early on, you police the skies. There's no medevac drops. You zone out your opponent's tank drops. Killing a couple of Vikings can sometimes be a huge hassle, so getting them this early is really nice for Ryong.
Mm-hmm. Well, those upgrades are like pretty substantial. Like, I know the plus two was like, what, like 45 seconds late for Byung, like maybe even a minute. And that can be a big deal, but these are like almost full upgrades behind here. Ryong also has just like straight up like a bigger army. Him moving out right now is a little bit scary.
Yeah, Byung is being perhaps a little too aggressive. And I don't mean this in terms of he's attacking Ryong, but he is getting very far out of his base. He's got the Vikings on patrol back here. He's going up for 6 because he did lose the 2 earlier. This should be able to pick up one of the medevacs, but definitely not both. Ryong should recognize this and turn around.
I was going to say, it's always tempting, but no, 4 Vikings way too much. So not going to get anything done here, and the upgrades are closing in on each other. We got second factory for Ryong. Byung should probably follow suit soon.
So this is a little bit worrisome for Byung, though. Not only is he getting picked off here and there and losing, like, you know, 2 Vikings, they are 4 Marines here, but he's slowly and steadily staying behind an army supply, too. Now down by almost 20. The upgrades are also a big point that you've been harping on. I'll bring up that, too. Like, again, it's not going to be, like, the difference of 1-1 or 2-2 versus 0-0, but Ryong should have an upgrade lead at opportune moments in the game.
Probably. He also just starts his vehicle weapons too, which is something that Byung hasn't done and maybe won't do, maybe forgets.
Byung and Ryong also go really high in SCVs right now, by the way. That's 70 plus say. For Terran is not
that
something that's normal.
I was going to say 71 was large, and then he went up 5 more. And I'm really surprised to see Ryong matching that too, because, you know, especially when you consider that last game, they had much faster fourths. So you could be like, okay, they're going to be like seriously saturated on 4 bases. That makes sense. They don't have fourths on the way. It's really interesting. They're going so far up in SCVs. Usually, if you're watching a Masters player, that's habit. You know, they're going to make as many SCVs as possible. They don't realize they're oversaturated. But for these guys, you would think that would be the case.
I can't believe he got the cancel on that tower, by the way. I thought that was certainly going to die. But, so, for all these things that are going good or bad for Beyond, I really like the Vikings the most. As you pointed out, you made too many get too late in the game, a little bit hard to handle. Like, they're really just not worth the dance. But I think this period of the game, Sensor Towers to the north, Vikings able to pick off Medivacs, Beyond should not be provided the opportunities to get in here. Beyond should have all of this on lockdown.
Yeah. I mean, they're probably both going to get maxed out. Yeah. Young is kind of posturing right here, but unless he scans and sees like a very opportune moment, like the tanks are still on medevacs and Beyond's not paying attention or something like that, there really should not be this really good situation where, yeah, it's like almost 40 army supply lead, like 30 army supply lead. That should be something pretty good, but tanks always just make that so much different. And maybe if he clicks, actually, because he will have 2-2-1, maybe if he clicks on the Marines, he might really go for it.
Well, the tank and the Marines just kind of positioned around the watchtower give Ryung a bit of an advantage in terms of taking engagements. But as pointed out, like, the Vikings can't extend too far. The Marines will pick them off. The Marines can't extend too far to chase the Vikings. The tanks will pick them off. So it's a bit of an awkward stalemate. Ryung's going to come in from behind, though, and try and make something happen. And honestly, more than SCV kills, if he killed an engineering bay for this drop, that would be so good for him. But looks like he's just going to drop a couple Marines. He's going for some SCV kills. Other side of the map, though, Beyond hits him up with a really big drop. Two medevacs come in. Tower goes down. Tanks respond. He's going to try and clean this up, but looks like, well, both are good about the same murder kills.
Yeah, like the damage is pretty even, and honestly, them losing about 10 SCVs is not that bad.
Well, Ryung actually was a little bit harder thanks to his upgrades. The 2-2 really showing there on the defense as he just barely cleans this up. Middle of the map still pushed back by the Vikings. Can't push in over there, but I think they both stabilized quite nicely. the reaction time, right?
Yeah, like this is. So, like in Brood War, actually, I really like those cameras. I feel like they did like a very good job with them, but that was not that good.
Well, Brood War is also very slow. Like, this isn't kind of fast paced. Don't kind of waste any engagements. You don't want them slightly.
Maybe a little bit.
Anyways, the Vikings going to be too much of a problem to deal with here, so he's going to fall back. And some of you might be wondering, like, why doesn't Ryung then just go into his own Vikings? And it's because catching up on those is really difficult.
Yeah.
So I love that Beyond takes advantage of that knowledge and goes for Liberators next. They're going to be able to leapfrog those tanks. Like, you'll see Liberators leapfrog Liberators. You can have Liberators leapfrog the tanks forward.
Yeah, that's a little bit of a concern as Liberators. But Ryung is actually going to go in for this. He has about 10 army supply lead, but
the
upgrades. Everything's actually even, but his positioning was great.
Yeah, and okay, Beyond takes a pretty big loss at the start of this. Most of that was in Vikings, so it's questionable whether they'd be good or not going forward. His tanks are going to have to hold the line the best they can. And they've got even upgrades right now. There's going to be about 30-40 seconds before that's a problem. Liberator's going to help push this back, though. I like that pickup.
A little bit. In fact, it's funny, though. Ryung actually probably has enough.
I think he could break this if he wanted to, but it would be costly. He knows that, so he's going to disengage.
Not necessarily breaking. I was going to say maybe try and snipe the Liberators. He does have like a 30 army supply lead, like 10 Marines getting blasted by the tanks. Might be worth making sure that he could stay there, but he just picks up and leaves and goes somewhere else. Liberators take a long time to reposition.
Oh, but he drops the tanks right into the mouth of the Marines, so they kill them real quick. Ryung's going to win the Marine fight, but unfortunately with the tanks shelling away from behind, he's got no way to contest that with only one tank of his own. He's got a lot of Marines, he's got a lot of army supply. Beyond's still trailing in that regard, but Ryung's also about to have that 3-3 upgrade advantage.
Yeah.
Beyond doesn't even have +3 armor on the way.
Yeah, that is actually really concerning. It's also concerning that Beyond has not gotten to a fourth base, and it's not like he's like rolling in cash right here. Okay, that drop was, I think, pretty good for Ryung. It's like a Viking way out, for Beyond. But, I mean, Quake Ryung, 20 army supply, I feel like that's actually going to be like 40 or 50 as he mules his fourth base, and of course it will be better upgraded.
Well, I'm interested to see how he uses the Liberators, I guess coming around the map looking for a bit of harass. It's not going to be super easy to clean up, but Marines are pretty quick, they're pretty mobile, if he's looking, but, and he is, so nice, pulls the SCVs out, loses one. Losing mining time on the mules kind of sucks, but it's better than losing the actual mineral line. Meanwhile, Tang's going to unload the middle of the map to get an advantage over Ryung. Where Ryung might be winning with bio, he's starting to lose out in the mech aspect of this. And you look at the production tab, there's not more tanks on the way. There's not three Liberators of tanks on the way.
Uh-oh.
He's going to try to push in with the Marines.
That was
15 Marines at a time. You could lose some Marines. So he's going to give chase. Overstims maybe a little bit. Pulls back. And he's going to have to heal up in those medevacs.
That was
But look at the production tab. He's actually not making any more mech units. There's no more medevacs, no Vikings. Finally, a tank pops up for the first time in a couple of minutes. I mean, 15 Marines at a time is nice, but you still need those tanks.
What's funny, though, is that like with a 40-50 army supply lead, he probably could just get a con game on all the tanks. Because now Beyond's problem is he doesn't have enough Marines. He will finish +3, but still be down 2 upgrades. It's a tank and the Marines, but Ryung is mostly Marines here. We got 4 tanks dropping. The con game is pretty good for Ryung. He's moving into the tanks. Vian might be able to hold again to the high ground, but he's running out of time to get that fourth base secured. It's actually in the bottom left right now, but Ryong could easily send Marines over there and kill it.
Yeah, he's actually doing that right now. Segments a couple off, not many, like three or four, and I like that choice. This is really problematic, though, because if Ryong's going to be able to keep mining, and you are just going like the Zap Brannigan strategy of throwing bodies at your opponent, with better Marines and better production, he'll eventually win out, just to brute force.
Yeah, this is what I was talking about. Like, that's the reason you don't really want to take that fourth base. At least it's a fourth base, right?
What but is driving those SCVs off? Or are they just lazy?
I'm not sure. But anyways, like, a couple Marines will give Vian a headache and might make him forced to look elsewhere. He really is depending on just tanks to cover him, and tank drops, of course, are very good. But you just need like 8+ tanks to like hold a line by themselves. Actually, I have a fight going in here, and this might just be the last one. Ryong has gone from 20 supply lead, 40 supply 60. Lead, to now 70 supply lead.
He's going to count up that's the SCVs, gets the tank as soon as it spawns. It's in such a bad spot for Bien. And well, he might push this back. There's still just no way to recover.
I mean, he knows the fourth base is down there. All he has to do is catch Bien kind of out of position once, and honestly, not even that out of position. Like, he can definitely take on Bien's army. But Bien, he wants to hold on. Like, he knows Ryong has a fourth base. He's probably guessing that Ryong has a fifth base, but he feels like he can do something.
Well, the armor finally kicks in for Bien, so he's been lacking in this regard for so very long, but it is a question of, like, is it too little? Is it too late? Down by less than half the army supply. Just in the absolute gutter right now.
Yeah. It's actually a little bit surprising that Bien is still in this so adamantly, as it's, you know, you're pinned back. You can barely defend your third base, much less your fourth base. There the Marines go. They're going to be able to snipe that third command center, and there
GG!
Is the GG.
Ryong ties it up 1-1. Also, just saw Ethan stopping by in chat. Make sure you guys give him some love, guys. Ethan with a heart, please. He's the guy on the floor for Twitch doing the production, helping us make sure we can do stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, he's looking very determined after that game.
Yeah, look at that. That, like, doesn't, it's look, like he lost.
I know, that doesn't look. He probably thinks, like, I won, but it wasn't good enough. Like, I gotta take it harder. It's beyond him fighting, right?
Like, thinker pose, too.
Yeah.
Just super into it.
The Korean version of the.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Well, we'll be getting into the next game as soon as possible, guys. I'm not sure how downtime will work, or if there are going to be breaks, or if there's going to be long periods of time.
Oh, no way. Are we in the client for StarCraft 2?
Are we in the client for StarCraft 2? If that's possible, can someone screenshot it? That
would
be super
that's
cool.
That's what they linked. So I think that's Boris.
Boris? Gyazo, time to take a look at this bad boy. Smooth. Hot gosh darn. That's awesome. Well, I'm trying not to swear.
I already said the F word. I got you covered.
But thank you, guys. And if I guess whoever's at Blizzard, thank you, too, for the support. That's really awesome to see. But let's see here. As we get into this, I'm looking around the crowd, and it just keeps getting bigger every time I look over. Like, this is just filling up like crazy. And, okay, maybe some of it's going to be beyond. But I guarantee you, like, because we're here for like a good, what, solid 3 hours or something? This is just going to get packed by the time we're done, regardless of who's playing.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the convention itself, like, this would probably be the only standing room in like a couple of hours. The convention is huge, but they're expecting hundreds of thousands of people.
If you guys have been to BlizzCon, it's like if they took all the layers of BlizzCon and instead of stacked them above each other, put them next to each other.
Yeah, next to each other, exactly. And this, like, connects apparently right to Shinsegae Mall. Which, if you don't know, like it's actually, like, I recognize that name because it is so, it's such a huge deal. But anyways, it connects right to basically a mall that covers, like, 15, 20 blocks, like, more. It's crazy.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to try and do these intros. We'll see how it goes. We are looking at the SCV currently, and it is tied up 1-1 in this best of 5. If you're just joining us, context being this is the semifinals of the Alima League year-end finals. And in the top left side, we've got the Red Terran player, Bien. Did they already just do intros that we missed?
Sometimes I feel like they aren't doing intros, guys. Like, sometimes I feel like they're doing the hype intros, and then otherwise they're like, oh, this guy.
Okay, well, that was Bien. You go
this
for this
guy. This is Ryong. He's cool.
Yeah, this is Ryong.
He's blue.
He's all right. He's okay.
He's okay.
That's the true question in chat. The 3+ year people tuning in. LSR says, I wonder if Rifkin's wearing pants today.
It would have been really awkward if he didn't.
I think that they would have just assumed I was some lousy white guy who just has
been
no
like
manners.
White people like shake their heads.
Doesn't know how to dress him.
Yeah, I mean, like, you know, at most it's like an amusing thing that they say to their friends. Yeah, I know.
Anyways, as we get to game number 3, I mean, there's a lot on the line for this. We're going to talk about the prize pool again for just a moment because there's a lot for first place. $3,000. A lot of cash. 1,000 for second, and of course 500 for third and fourth. So
yeah.
All the players who attended today are getting some cash, but they're all gunning for that first place finish.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that's already pretty good. This is a reward for like being the best in the Alima League. Actually, okay, so a lot of these guys are Alima League regulars, Ryung, Byun, Gumiho, all the time in Alima League. Su is kind of the one that's like, okay, he was like kind of too
he's
big
like
of a deal.
Guy. He was like late
you know?
To the party too.
Yeah, because he was like, on SKT, like his family didn't want him to go to the party, and then like they disowned him, you know, like he's good to go. But he was quite lucky.
Are you going to hang out with those Terrans that do all the marijuanas?
Exactly. But it was the last month, actually, I think, that he was the one that got the spot.
Yeah, he won one of the monthly finals. We'll go over that, of course, when we get to him later. For Ryung, though, I guess it needs to be mentioned in case he's like, I don't think he's anywhere close to out. This is League of Legends. Get out of here. Ryung has had 4 second place finishes in a row, and recently, too. This isn't like pulling stats from like 2 or 3 months ago. Ryung has regularly been in the finals of the Alima League Grand Finals, monthly finals of the just weekly cups. He even actually beat Byun. I want to say it was like the 2 months ago monthly finals. It was a 3-1 score. It's the one you cast I wasn't there for.
Yeah. That was actually... I remember because you asked me like literally the week after, like what happened, and I was like, I don't know.
I don't remember because I was so tired from solo casting. You abandoned me, Rifkin.
Yeah, exactly. But it was good. Of course, like everything that they're gonna do together is going to be really good. Like it might be that Byun is number one in everyone's hearts and every like casual StarCraft viewers, of course, as well, because he won BlizzCon. But Ryung, this is his jam. All right, like his TPT is probably gonna be good. Like say he wins and he wins against like Sue or something like that, it'll be good. But TVT is where Ryung was going to do the best.
I think, okay, there's yes to that regard, but I love that these two have such a big history playing each other. Like,
yeah.
I feel with all the Corsair Cups and the random things we cast, these guys really fight each other once in a blue moon, and so it's not that interesting. These guys have a story behind them.
Yeah, we do have a little bit of a you know an issue here where you can't go and put SPs down, but it's not too big of a deal. Again, they're both like going to that third CC. But I was going to say, like, it's always a little interesting. This is like BM or anything, but you hear the WCS guys talk about, or the IM guys or whatever, talk about like, well, the recent history is blank, blank, and blank, and they never mentioned the tournament. I just want to be like, the recent history of Byun and Ryung, Alima League, Alima League, Alima League. Like, I actually want to say the name of the tournament, because that's what we get when we do online tournaments all the time, is we get to watch the history of all these independent cups. If we do a European Grand Finals for Corsair Cup, we would have so much history as well.
That is kind of cool, actually. That's one thing I think we've got going, where we have seen everything from everything. But credit where it's due, they do reference Base Trade TV events when they can, especially GSL and stuff. Been really cool to see over the past year. A little bit of a scary scuffle there outside the base, but again, it's not that we don't think this is important, but this is such a wash when it comes to those early engagements. The follow-up to this, the Banshee can beat the tank, the Hellions can beat the Marines. Ryung should not die to what's coming his way.
No. I'd be really surprised, again, with like both of their skill in this matchup, that it would snowball so drastically, but it would. There's always a chance in TBT, especially. So this is kind of the push that Byun intended to do in that last game, or the game before that rather, King Sejong, and got denied because that Viking Cyclone. It starts earlier, it's a little bit smaller, but he has that full potential of the meta back.
He also gets control of the ramp, which is not something easily taken back. So the Banshee is really going to be what saves him here. But getting to the top of the ramp, I think, would have been a better place to police. Instead, Byun gets a little bit greedy, goes for the mineral lines. He kills a couple of SCVs for his trouble, and maybe even some of the Marines on the way back. But he's going to lose this drop, and it's not going to do that much in the end.
Yeah, you know, he ended up getting a lot of the army as it was all clumped up. You know, Ryung's SimCity kind of working against him right there. But we did have that. Oh, that Banshee doing a lot more work.
Well, trying to at least.
Trying
it's not
going to
be a lot done initially. It's going to get caught, so it's going to go down. Really unfortunate. He needed that to get some kills to make up for the losses. He's on 11 dead SCVs right now. That's not a good feeling. But the nice thing about TVT is recovery is totally possible thanks to Mule. So
it's true. Yeah.
This is bad for Ryung. Don't get me wrong, but he's not out of the game like if this was another race.
Yeah, Ryung, if he gets 10 SCVs with that Banshee, which is totally possible, right? He just got that scan right on him. It's so much better, but yeah, I was going to say, is it a third CC already on the way for Byun? And that's a little bit scary.
Even if he doesn't kill the ten SCVs, even if he doesn't kill the CC, what's nice about the dynamic of Terran, though, is you do have those tanks. And if you use your tanks well, they can win smaller numbers against bigger numbers.
Yeah. What I really like about TVT, or like Terran, I guess, in general, and their ability to come back, and a lot of people will point to Mules, that's absolutely true. Other races don't have mineral gatherers if they lose mineral gatherers. But it's also like tech wise, you know, like the ability of the medevac, that tech, as well as the like just the micro ability of the medevac means that like a Terran could always bring stuff back. That's why it's a scrappy race, all right?
Scrappy but very fun, I will say that much. It took 4 years for me to make TVT not one of my favorite matchups. Like right now, I think TVP, TVZ, like the non-TVT matchups are looking a lot better.
I actually really did not like Heart of the Swarm. That's going to go down. I didn't like Heart of the Swarm TVT. I didn't like playing it. I didn't really like casting it either, to be honest. It was just mass drops everywhere. But I, we are that rare like duo of people that actually like tank drops. So
I know. We're like the only ones advocating it. I think it's because Archon mode ruined us. I was just like so hung up on it. Now, this push comes to the middle of the map. Beyond, once again, has a bigger army supply. He's got a better economy bond. This is third base. Will probably be better functioning, but it's not down yet. So Ryung is maybe going to catch up through that.
Yeah. I think that he could, like, the being on location is pretty good. I think Beyond's still waiting maybe for his Oracle.
Well, other side of the map, too. I think that Banshee went in there, and it's delaying it even further. Viking's going to take a fight at the top of the map. This will go in Ryung's favor, and this will stop the push entirely.
It's like, I think it's like a dynamic of them knowing TBT so well, knowing each other so well, that they constantly match each other on Vikings. Because that thing that Beyond does, I feel like a lot of worse players feel very uncomfortable doing. That's only tanks and only Vikings. If a couple Marines get in there and like snipe your tank, you're like, it's like, oh, that was totally not worth it. But Ryung's actually matching him on Vikings, of course, which means that he still cannot like go forward with his two tanks. That two tanks can actually do a lot of damage when they cover each other. They can get a lot of Marines, they can get the SCVs, they can force a liftoff, even if they really don't have a response, but if they only have like their own Marines and tanks. It could be scary stuff, but they're like deflecting each other's blows. Ryung is down in supply, but it is these tiny things like getting the third command center down a location faster, starting with three SCVs at a time a little bit faster. And any engagement that goes on from here can easily sway 1% in another's favor. Ryung's only so far behind in these upgrades.
Yeah. Viking's gonna catch the Banshee. Oh, that's unfortunate. That's gonna like, you shouldn't be here. I shouldn't have been there. Let's just accept the loss. I will say it's interesting how late to the party upgrades have been. Not in terms of like, oh my god, these upgrades are late, but there's definitely a lot less priority on them and a lot more on getting the tanks out sooner, getting that Banshee out a little bit sooner, that cloak out. I'm wondering if one of these guys through this best of five just cuts and says, you know what, normally I go cloak, let's cut it and just get plus one really quick. Will that be like a game changer?
I feel like the only person who's ever tried to do like specifically fast upgrades was Marine King.
Yeah.
He tried.
And
it
he would,
really
you know
work.
What? Sometimes it would though. Sometimes
okay,
it would
okay, look, there was like
really,
one
really
game,
work.
Right?
That
like,
one game where he rushed to plus three.
Yeah, that was okay.
All right, middle of the map, Viking control going to go in the favor of Beyond. There's not enough on the ground.
Oh,
he's best off just getting the tanks out while he can. The Vikings debate chasing, though. That gives Ryung a little bit of an opportunity to get a couple of extra shots in. But as stated before, it's going to go in the favor of Beyond. But what's
he
coming?
Needed.
But two tanks? That's easy to hold.
Yeah, but what's coming behind that is not going to be easy to hold. Like, Ryung really thought he would have at least equal Vikings because honestly, not many Terrans get more than five, I would say. You know, they're going to stop on four.
Exactly.
But no more than five, usually. They actually went up to six versus four, so or three, I can remember. But it was a pretty big deal. And of course, now it's going to be a tough time. These two tanks, like, two tanks do not sound that difficult. And it's not doing, like, game-ending damage.
But they can't be stopped.
But they can't be stopped.
Look at Ryung's army supply. That's the biggest problem.
I mean, he instantly lost, like, 15-20 of it in those Vikings. So that did not help whatsoever. Like, if he had that air control and he just camped his own ramps, his third ramp
frustrated.
And the main ramp, he would hold easily, so, but now it's a little more in the air. He doesn't have Viking control. Well, he just
in the air. Got it. Ha. I love that he chose to go for the break with those Marines. It was a little bit worrisome because I think he's fully aware how little his army supply is, but playing a bit of a bluff with Beyond at the same time. Like, Beyond could have just moved through the middle of the map had he realized there was no army supply out of Ryung. But Ryung had to keep up appearances, making it look like that wasn't quite the case. Now, on the right side, there's a small drop. It will get scouted by Ryung, by the way. I like this. The Marines just being sent out to look what's coming. Sees the attack in the middle of the map. And the Vikings, okay, still gonna be a bit of a problem, but two Vikings is so much easier to deal with than six.
Yeah, and he has his own two Vikings. This it's not a case where he is just getting owned and he's gonna be pushed in through here. This ramp is like super important. If Beyond at any point goes to the right where there's no ramp and not even really a choke, he has a lot more room to work with like the 30 army supply lead. But here, this is where Ryung is hoping that he'll be able to hold until somewhat near max out. Because of course, Beyond's getting advantages elsewhere. He's getting a fourth base. He doesn't even have to worry about drops right now. Like maybe a single drop could happen, but even then, it's going to be something easy to clean up with. And he's still winning for sure, but Ryung can hold.
It reminds me a little bit of that first game, actually, where Ryung was coming in with upgrades, but it rings, and it looked like it should have been going well for him.
Exactly.
And fell apart. Same thing might happen here, because game two was the same situation, but a different outcome. Game three for Ryung, I think defensively it's not too much to ask of him, but it is a question of like, that army supply is missing, that 30 supply difference, the upgrades being behind. Can he make that magic happen?
Yeah, unfortunately, at any point that Byung pulls Ryung apart just means that it's so much more likely he's going to get stomped.
He's about to get stretched apart like Taffy, man. Like, look
yeah,
at this.
Exactly.
He's attacking big on the third. He's dropping in the main. He's already dropped in the natural. There's no way Ryung can respond to all three locations appropriately at the same time. SCVs get pulled to the slaughter.
Yeah, and because he's distracted everywhere, the tanks are really, his tanks have demolished. The Marines are going to follow suit. That's going to be it. Byung gets that 2-1 lead.
But of course, this is where I really need to remind people that it's a lead, not a victory. This is, of course, a best of five, not a best of three, as classically would happen. Again, I haven't been able to check Twitter. I want to the second we get a break. So again, if you guys see your name scrolling down here, please take a screenshot and tweet it at us. We'd love to see you to support the Lima League. I know it's kind of late, and I super love everybody tuning in. And a super special thank you to all the new people, whether you're from the front page of Twitch or from just the StarCraft client. I hope you're enjoying what you see. It might be a TVT now, but you're going to have that TVZ afterwards also.
Yeah, that Gumiho versus Sue series should be like, it might be one-sided, to be honest, considering the last time that the guys played, but it should be really entertaining.
So I asked Gumiho, actually. I said, like, do you know that your foreign audience loves that you play mech? And he's like, what? Like, basically nobody's complimented him on playing mech before ever. And I'm just kind of like, oh, that's interesting.
What probably happens is teammates are like, you dummy.
Yeah, you so play mech. Lost, idiot. No, so I asked him, like, you know, what are your plans for Sue? And he's like, no mech, win.
No mech win.
So I don't know if that'll be the direction he goes. Of course, for Ryung and Byung, what I love is we've actually seen Byung try mech and not so good. I don't know if Ryung would go that direction in a TVT, but I'm certain neither of them would go that versus Sue, should that be the finals.
Oh, yeah, versus Zerg? No, I agree, though. Like, sometimes you'll see the Terrans experiment with each other.
That could have been phrased so much better.
The mech game can sometimes happen for people who never play mech.
So it's like we got strangers walking in front of the camera. We just had a production guy walking in front of the camera. Luckily, we weren't on the camera seat, so it doesn't matter. But I think we're getting ready to go into the next game. I hear some yelling. I see the player cameras.
Woo! Let's do it. We get a new sub thanks to ZK Dial.
Yeah, for the Twitch Prime sub. Again, I'll stress this, guys. We love you so much, but we can't get Twitch alerts working here in Korea. So we can't, unfortunately, monitor subs like we normally do. So please understand if you sub today and we miss your message, we still love you. We still appreciate you.
Yeah, there's about 10 lines at a time with what we have right now. So if you're in those 10 lines and we look as a sub, then you did it.
All right, well, ladies and gentlemen, game number 4. This could decide everything. In the bottom right side, he's on his last life. In the top left, he's up 2-1. It's going to be Byung.
In the bottom right, as the blue Terran, he is Ryung.
Yeah, I guess it's a bit of a fumble because we do actually do our intros different than other people. I know that some of the foreign casters are in the same mentality of we do it, but I guess in Korea, not quite the same. I do want to point out, too, if you guys aren't watching the Lima League Korean stream, they do have a little bit more of a shiny-looking stream, and they've got the player cameras up, so you should absolutely have that going on a second monitor also watching. That's over at twitch.tv/LimaLeague.
Yep. Kind of wish we did. Those games are so cool, but it's okay. So it is Apotheosis. The way that usually goes for the Lima League is that the first map is chosen for you, and then you have loser's pick after that. I assume that was the way we're doing it today, but I'm not sure.
It may have been pre-Vetoes, because this was really quick, game into game. I actually think Vetoes are probably a little bit more efficient for a live tournament, too, because you don't waste time.
Yeah, efficient. I mean, it actually seems a little bit more official, too. Like, really, the reason you do the way that we do online cups is because they're online, and otherwise you're going to have, like, people taking forever to do Vetoes, you know? But I'm not sure. You almost, like, batted that into my mouth, okay?
Sorry.
Like, a fly, all right?
It's a mosquito. It's a difference. I don't want to get sick.
That wasn't a mosquito.
I think it was.
Okay,
well regardless. Thank you, Zangryo. My apologies.
Wait a minute. What are you? I thought you were going to, like, thank me sarcastically for interrupting, but then you said sorry.
It was, and I was being apologetic for being sarcastic. So there you have it.
Okay, that makes sense. Whatever. But anyways, the point is I brought up the map because, of course, you would see you 3 games so far. They've gotten the third CCs, you know, regardless of, like, whether they're in a lead or not. It's been a 3 CCs, sometimes even a 4th. Most of the times a 4th. Here on Apotheosis, you would think again, like, okay, 3 CCs, probably getting that gold base, they're going to try to, although it's very dangerous to do in TBT, so maybe not. But Ryung actually goes for a 1 base opener for now. It seems like it's going to be a factory expand, so not, like, you know, seriously 1 base at the starport, but it's still interesting that he would choose this map to do it on.
Well, Command Center gets slapped down, so maybe not fully committing to too much. I mean,
well, I said he was a factory expand.
Yeah, but what I thought was going to happen there was it'd be a lot more emphasis on the Hellions. Running across the big map like Apotheosis, you wouldn't see it coming. But unfortunately, rip.
Well, anyways, so the Command Center is going to be a little bit far behind. And it's just like, this is where, like, you, the apotheosis and having the distance is that if it's going to snowball, you usually have to stop rallying forward, whether it's a Hellion or a Reaper. So, Frozen Sample, super short rushes, it's natural to natural. That is very, very scary. Or through XG Brew as well, which we haven't seen so yet. But Apotheosis, I wonder why he did that. It does protect him a little bit more as well if Yun was doing something super weird, like a proxy Reaper, for instance. And actually, the more I think about it, the more I work through this, It's probably the reason that Ryung did that. Actually, Yun does proxy Reapers on Apotheosis.
That's true, but this is also really bad. The two Reapers get in, and there's no opposition.
Yeah, so as good as his like defense should have been, he was, I guess, maybe doing a front attack or just, you know, the Reapers.
He was expecting the Hellion skip with the Reaper. He was expecting the classic fight at the start of the game. Because they went around the side, four workers died for it. This is nice for Bian, but a small slip up out of Ryung.
For sure. And again, consider that his orbital is only just now finishing up, so like any economic damage is actually kind of big. Chances are it's going to even out as they get into the third CCs, if they get into the third CCs, which is basically a guarantee. It's just a question of where do they put their third CC.
Well, I'm really, really hoping, by the way, Ryung can bring this back. I'm just going to put all my cards on the table, guys, and you see some of you cheering in for him in chat. I want Ryung to go game five with Bian. I want him to show that he is, in fact, this Terran that has proved and can contest with the BlizzCon champion, because we've seen it happen before, and we'll see it happen again. But I want it to happen here and now today in the Elite League finals.
Yeah. I mean, I anticipated a 3-1 for Bian, I would say, my guess. But the 3-2 for Ryung or Bian, I think, is like the much safer bet for how closely matched they are.
Yeah.
I think Bian's been on a high recently. He did lose in the VSL, but I still think that he is the fan favorite, for sure, all those fangirls in the front, but also just the favorite in general to win the Illuma League.
Well, it's not only just that, but you consider the games they play against each other. Like, okay, sometimes it trades off 3-1 for one and then one for the other. But it's never a 3-0. It's never a 2-0. These guys always end up taking a game.
Yeah. Well, the Liberator's going to get in here. And
it's such an odd thing to see.
Maybe do a bit of damage. Ryung did see that with his Hellion. And actually, the Cyclones are already over here. So, oh, nope, they couldn't get a lock on.
Okay, well, if that's going to be a bit of a miss as he flies into the main, SCVs are going to have to get pulled. I'd say a lot of them are low, so it's worrisome. They're going to get one shot anyways. It's a freaking Liberator. The splits are good, though. Oh, that last second, like, triple split helps clean this up. Cyclones have to wrap around the backside. That might leave him vulnerable in the front. I think Bian knows this too, so he's going to try and bait this out.
Yeah.
There's the lock on. Double lock on.
Yeah, that's going to do it.
That's going to do it. He loses some minerals for him, probably about 1,000 worth of no mining. It kind of sucks. But at the same time, Bian was not fast enough. I think if he had been there a little bit quicker, he would have known, like, okay, Cyclones are the main time to attack the third.
Yeah. I mean, the fact that Ryung got his third on the gold base, though, should still be, like, a good point of contention for Bian. So he's not actually going to siege up on the low ground. He's just Viking for control. He's going to try and go through the natural and the third base. But it's still the point of, like, Ryung's in a third base to take care of. It's not something that Bian has to worry about yet. And he's not quite in position to save his natural and his third base. He's saving his third,
If Bian knocked down the rocks, all the Cyclones and Hellions would have just been taken out of the fight. He could have gone to the natural. So not taking advantage of the rock tower.
You should do that now.
Yeah, he could still do that. He's still going to like to push it. Maybe he wants to save it for later.
Oh, God. Oh, no. Oh, Jesus, no.
Picking up a tank. The tank at the backside picking off some of the SCVs, but not hitting the Cyclones. Really need to hit that Cyclone, actually. Because while the tank might die, the Cyclones will kite this army down.
Crazy damage. I mean, the SCVs are going to be lost eventually anyway to that one tank.
13,
that's really annoying.
13.
But of course, pulling them in like that, letting his tank die in the natural, not having that sieged up ready to go, and not having a medevac to accompany it, that was a lot of damage. That was game-ending damage. I mean, the fact that he's a third base already on location and on the gold base is nice, but of course, Bian's going to be only seconds behind on the gold base. He knows he has a lead.
I mean, right now, it's 33 workers to 58. Again, in most normal circumstances, I don't think that's too bad. But the fact that Ryung's trailing an army so far behind two, it just really drives that home.
He needs, it's the thing about Frozen Temple was that there's 3 points of contention on Frozen Temple, and that's great. But like, it's still kind of like a triangle-based layout where you can try to protect each other. You know, missiles are here, missiles are there, and you're pretty good. Apotheosis, you have like, again, a triangle a little bit, but you have all that space off to the right. You can surprise them on the left. You can still go through the middle. You could siege up on the gold base ledge if you have that Viking control, or if no one has Viking control and just scan. There's like, I feel like there's less chance actually that Ryung will be able to defend against everything. Bian's going to hit them with a 1-2 punch again to just like solidify the win here, because he certainly has a lead up 20 workers. Ryung is supply block right now. He's like really supply blocked right now.
And
oh,
I think
God.
We'll go back to the production tab for a second, too. Okay, so 1-1 to finish up for Ryong. That's kind of nice. But I think I saw Combat Shield's offset, and that's what I was really curious about.
Yeah. This is, this might be a death push. Actually, this probably won't be. It's only the two tanks and a couple Marines. But whatever follows this is probably going to be the death push. Ryong, his last chance would be to just, like, have, like, the best hold ever. Like, hope that Ryong's tank drops are terrible, or hope that he's, like, distracted dealing with this medevac drop.
Well, the medevac drop actually finds a tank to ward it off, so that's going to be kind of bad. It's 27 Marines to 17.
Oh, he's a tank. So Ryong's going to have to lift that third CC, probably try to take another location,
that's
or just
late.
Tap out. GG.
GG.
Too bad.
Oh, that's so... I mean, first, I'm happy for Beyond, obviously. Congratulations. But sad for Ryong, who... You know, he was definitely the underdog, I think, of everybody, the one we were cheering for as well.
Yeah. Like, underdog is, like, too strong of a word, though, right? Because he has been the guy to try and take on Byun. If anyone was going to do it, it probably was going to be a Zerg. It's probably going to be a Terran. And a Terran like Ryong. But unfortunately, not going to happen today. He's going to get that 3-1 loss. But he still gets $500.
Yeah, $500 for losing. I mean, I don't know how long he had to train out here to get to Busan, but it's not too bad. Obviously, up next, though, is going to be Gumiho for Sue. We're not sure what the schedule is like for that. I know that when we're casting this live week to week, we usually have to wait about 10 minutes between each match, and that's because the VSL studios do it.
Take a break,
I'm not sure how it's going to work here. I'm actually going to try and find somebody from production and ask in a moment. Just kind of come back to Byun eating something, I guess.
Yeah. Oops. He was eating something. Maybe it was like the hand warmers he was opening.
You know, every time this comes in, I'm going to stick my hand out. I need to make like a sign and just have like English here or something to wave out.
That'd work.
Yeah, it's really cool seeing the stage and the glory. And you guys, by the way, still can't even see. Like, I really wish I could turn this camera around. There's so much more that way. There's all these games here. Mm-hmm. I know Hard Revenge is probably tuning in, so I got to shout out. They got a DFO section, dude. I can't wait to go check it out. The Nexon booth, which is so packed that way. This event is massive. G-Star is what it's called, right?
Correct. That is the convention name.
G-Star is the convention. It's
yeah.
Crazy gaming right here. It's starting to get a little bit warm. I'm starting to see a lot of people start fanning their faces too. I'm feeling that one as well. But I think what we're going to do is hit up a small break, guys, while we try and find some production people and ask what's going on. We're also going to see if we can maybe get player cams going.
That'd be cool. That'd be really cool.
It would be really cool. I think, though, that... yeah, I'm going to have to actually physically get up and go look for somebody. So we're going to put ourselves on a break. We love your faces. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back, I guess, in a little bit with more...
of the Elima League.
I'm actually trying to remember if I have...
He just stops midway.
Okay, I've got this scene we can use. Sorry, no, I was just trying to think what we can do because we have to mute our mics and then it'll be like, what's going on? I don't know what's happening. So, title T, be back soon with Gumiho versus Sue.
Amazing.
I know, number
production.
One production in Korea. All right, we'll see you guys shortly.